Okay, thank you so much. So my name is Laurent. So I'm going to give you, I'm going to try to give you a sense of the research program we are developing about what we call behavioral objects. And a great part, a large part of my talk will be about this notion, how to define this kind of object which are having a special sense of being in space, having a social presence or having a behavior. So this is part of the research program which is called Behavior and has been developed mostly inside the Inside Lab, which is an art and design school in Paris, and which I am part of. This program has been initiated in 2012, mostly by Emmanuelle Quinz and Samuel Bianchini. By the way, Samuel was supposed to come today to give his presentation. So. And this research program is about behavioral objects. Behavioral objects are this kind of objects. Of course, they are not about sweeping the floor. They are about many more dimensions, many more aspects. Essentially, behavioral objects are awkward assembly, awkward. They are not humanoid nor zoomorphic. They don't serve a specific function. And they are not intelligent. They just have a form of expressivity, which stem basically from the way they move into space. So I'm going to try to give a definition of this behavioral object, coming from three different stances, conceptual stances. We're going to look into the notion of history of art, behavioral object as an aesthetical concept. We're going also to look into the notion of agency, with the idea that behavioral objects have a specific kind of agency. We're also going to look into the notion of material intelligence, the fact that even if these objects are not specifically intelligent, they're quite dumb actually, but they have a kind of material intelligence which is coming from a sort of complex interaction between different components, and also coming from the material which they are composed of. Let's start with the notion of history of art. So this notion of behavior object firstly came, I guess, from an historical perspective. The fact that from the 50s, some objects which appear and have specific properties, they are actually not static, they are like a living sculpture, like living objects which have capacity to sense their environment, to act also toward their environment, to have a specific presence, which is not coming so from their appearance, because they are not, they are quite abstract structure, but they are they have a behavior. So in that sense, this kind of behavior object represent a shift in perspective in the domain of history of art. So you were starting from the experimentation with motion in kinetic art, mostly. Kinetic art being a form of formal composition. And then you introduce behavior, which give this object a different position with respect to their environment. This is one of the artworks which has been produced as a result of experimentation in the behavioral research program. This is a frame, an empty frame, and as you can see, there are subtle movements which animate with this wooden frame. What's interesting in this artwork is that the frame, the place where the representation should be, is empty. And the representation is not inside the representation. The representation is the behavior of you. So this is a nice illustration of the kind of shift there is when you introduce behavior as a form of representation, as a form of signifying something which is inferred from the observer, which is contemplating this subtle movement. So behavioral objects is an aesthetical concept. This is also a notion which is strongly related to the sense of agency. These objects give a sense of having a purpose, even if they don't have a function. Actually, we are more interested in objects which don't have a specific function, which are purposeless, but give a sense of independence, of autonomy, just by the way they are moving into space, and also from the indifference that they manifest. Actually, behavioral objects often are objects that don't give a damn about you. They're just doing what they do without trying to interact with you. There's also this notion which has been examined a while ago by Ken this morning, the uncanny. There's also this notion that behavior objects are associated with a slight form of uncanny, which is not uncanny valley, because we are not interested in that part of bizarre coming from the resemblance with a human being or even with an animal. This uncanny feeling is coming from the fact that these objects have a form of independence. They don't give a damn about you, and this is strange. These are objects made by humans, but they don't care about humans. This is also related to the notion of misbehavior that we're trying to develop. Object with misbehavior. What does it mean? Actually, this is the fact that object can even be disabled object, awkward, can having difficulties performing a function or what we expect from them. It's also the sense that they can be play tricks on you. They can be tricky. This is even more, even more interesting, because this reinforces the sense that they have an autonomy, a sense of agency, which is not coming from the relationship between human and being. It's coming from their own volition. Of course, all these things are something we attribute to them. They are not designed with these kind of properties because they are not intelligent, they are not sophisticated. They are basically objects which, from their motion, triggers this sense of agency, of purpose, of indifference or misbehavior. This is one of the examples which has been presented this morning by the Celeste Borsinus artwork, which is called Off-World, developed in 2014. So it's about grand candles that move inside the room very slowly. And what's interesting to me in this artwork is the sense of indifference manifested by these pianos, which are moving from, we don't know exactly which bottle. This is not clear from what they do, but they have a sense of what they are doing. But this sense may be remain mysterious. But there's also an agency in the sense that they are giving the impression that their movement is organized. This is not completely random, even if it is at the algorithmic level. The adjustment, the composition, the emergent composition that arrives from time is an interesting part of the artwork. It's also coming from the relationship between certain motion, certain relationship between the different objects, and an observer, human observer, who have the capacity to interpret this motion and give meaning to this configuration. This is the other example presented this morning. The transhumous also this sense, the sense that these objects have a specific purpose, which has nothing to do with human social norms. During this research program about behavior and behavioral object, we try to develop some conceptual framework to allow to characterize the sense of agency that we may have in front of these objects, which are very different in terms of the structure they are composed of, in terms of the movement they can perform in space. So we distinguish three different levels of agency, which might be useful to characterize the impression that we feel when confronted to this particular object. And we start with the first level, which is called animacy, simple animacy, which is a basic level of agency. This is only, imagine a fly, for instance. This is moving in a very spontaneous way and quite erratic. This is random. This is not purposeful. This is only an object which has a volition, a way of being, of manifesting a certain spontaneity. And the next step in this mode of interpretation is agency, the sense of agency coming from the impression that the object is following as a certain intention. For instance, imagine a dot moving consistently in a certain direction toward an object. This is the impression that the object is following a consistent trajectory and therefore may be interpreted as goal-oriented, which was not the case at the previous level. So we have crossed a level of complexity in terms of interpretation, and the attributes, the psychological attributes we may infer from this motion are more rich and complex. The next step, and the one that few behavioral objects are attaining, is the mental agency level, which is related to the sociability. This is also about intentional movement, but these ones are coordinated, are related to some social aspects. For instance, two dots moving together, one giving the impression of chasing the other one. And this impression is quite different from, quite distinct from the other one, in the sense that you don't have this impression of an object being alone in its world. No, it's coordinated toward other beings, and possibly coordinated toward mental properties, such as goal or desires or purpose. So I was saying a while ago that behavioral objects are not specifically intelligent. They are not designed to be intelligent, or they are not supposed to be very sophisticated in terms of artificial intelligence. We are not concerned about this aspect. We are not developing smart objects. We are more concerned about what I would call material intelligence. And this material intelligence is coming from a web of factors which are interacting sometimes in complex feedback loops. You can consider, for instance, the motion directive, the algorithm, or the possibility, the potentialities of motion of the object. Can it move forward? Can it rotate? And can it move in a constant manner or with acceleration and so on? You're also going to consider the material in which it is composed of, and which is going to determine the way it's going to move or transform. You also have to introduce a part of noise into the system, which is also going to affect the way the movement is looking. And you have to consider the context in which the movement is taking place. This is not a movement taking place in the void, but actually inside a specific context. This might be an installation, a museum, this can be a classroom, and this is going to affect the way we give meaning to this motion. This brings me to the last component, which is naive psychology. Actually, the concept we have, naive concept we have, and that gives us the possibility to say this motion is intentional, or this motion is random, or this motion is manifesting an emotion, for instance. All these components are interacting in producing what I would call emergent behavior, which is not, again, which is something dissociated from the complexity of artificial intelligence. So in order to experiment with this behavior, with this behavioral object, we needed a tool to conceive, to experiment and prototype with different objects. To this purpose, we decided to conceive our own robotic toolkit, a modular toolkit, which is composed of different structures and different robotic components, such as actuators, sensors, and also a microcontroller. So after having experimented with different modular robotic toolkits such as Lego Mindstorm, we decided that we wanted something more flexible, something more sturdy, in order to easily conceive behavioral objects, which are not complex but can be assembled very quickly. And so it's like a Lego, basically. You have different parts which are covered with Velcro in order for them to be attached very quickly. We're also developing the software aspect. And today, this is the last version that allows you to control the different motors, either in joint or wheel mode, and also to register certain animations. So if you want to record, for instance, this this motor making a certain amount of movement or having a certain velocity, you're going to record this and you're going to trigger this animation, possibly in association with a sensor. You're going to have a threshold, and below this threshold or above this threshold, then you're going to trigger this animation. So this toolkit, which is, again, very easy to use, has been used in many workshops, research workshops, but also class workshops or children workshops, in order to conceive these different objects. And the first object has been, the first workshop has been experimented in 2014 for the tangible embedded and embodied interaction with Hiroshi Ishii. Also, we have developed a workshop at Montreal with Nicolas Ruiz. These different workshops have led to the realization of different objects. For instance, the Benoît Verja autonomous subjective instrument, which is a kind of meter that is used by bricklayers and try to move around like a snake, trying to measure what's around him. We also have experimented with what we call disabled objects. This is this object that, for instance, the disabled chair, which is a prototype, that would be the idea that an object is manifesting difficulties to move around, and so it's going to give us a sense of empathy and possibly it's giving the impression that it needs help. The behavioral research program has also resulted in many publications. One of them is dedicated to the work of Céleste Boursier-Mogenot, which is called Behavioral Object, and this is the first part of a trilogy. The first one was published in 2017. The second one will be in 2018. And will be dedicated to an atlas of behavioral objects from different perspectives, robotics, anthropology, psychology, and history of art. And the third one will be finally dedicated to the notion of workshop and practice-based research. So one of the questions when we experiment with this behavioral object, this notion of emergent behavior and the fact that we experiment and this sense of serendipity which is involved in the fact of experimenting with this object is the question of how do we pass from this experimentation to a full-fledged behavioral artwork. And this is the fact that this emergent behavior is harnessed through workshop and installation which feed a conceptual and practical endeavors, the toolkit development in the one end and the conceptual frameworks in the other end, which lead to new experimentation and then give rise to a new emergent behaviors and a sense of serendipity that you can use further to develop more tools and frameworks. Well, thank you so much.